595.1 presents Youth on the Rise. A radio show by the youth for the youth. Join your hosts, Craig Hardell and Tanya Elias, as we shed light on pertinent topics at the cornerstone of our lives and our nation. Tune in to hear our guests every Monday night from 8 to 9 p.m. as we impart knowledge and guidance to our listeners. Don't forget, every Monday night from 8 to 9 p.m. on Live 95.1 FM. Youth on the Rise. Good evening, listeners from Choiseul, St.Lucia, and online. Welcome to another episode of Youth on the Rise. Again, I am your host, Craig Hardell. And this evening, we have a very pertinent topic to speak about. And this evening, we are discussing exam preparation. Again, you know, it's a time of the year where schooling at whatever level are preparing for exams, whether you attend primary school, secondary, tertiary, university. You are just about at the point where you actually preparing for your exams, whether it's first term, whether it's last semester, whether it's end of year, you are in exam preparation mode. And people, to encapsulate this all, to begin this segment, I have one quote here. And people, we should always know that, and I quote, before anything else, preparation is the key to success. Again, before anything else, preparation is the key to success. That is by Alexander Graham Bell. People, first things first. Whatever level you're at, it is paramount that you take exams seriously. It's paramount that you prepare. It's paramount that you put in the time. All right? And for this evening segment, again, listeners, you started a little after 8 here. I'm going to give tips on all three levels, okay? Focus on primary at the beginning, secondary, and then towards the last part of the segment, we'll touch on tertiary level. It's necessary to give for all three. Of course, all three have exams. However, the intensity of preparation, the difficulty of the material, and sometimes even the environment that students are around, be it in school or at home, is a bit different. And of course, many things are the same, but there are certain distinctions that are to be made. And we are going to cover that this evening. Okay? Now, we are going to begin with primary level. Okay? Firstly, it is essential that students make sure they take proper notes. Okay? Make sure they take proper notes. And make sure they understand what is there. Now, many primary school students have a tendency to take the notes down, put the books in the bag, and not open it until the next day. Right? So when they get home, all they do is play. And all they do again, the next time they open the book, is that they go back to school, all right? So they don't have the habit of going over what they've done throughout the day. And listeners, for the material to stick, for you to be able to apply what you've learned, for you to be able to understand what you've learned, it is very important that students revise the notes. Okay? Revision is key here. And not just revision, but making sure that they understand what they have written. And it is through revising that they may discover sticking points, things that they are not certain about. Okay? Sometimes, if the notes are not read out to them, they copy something wrongly, whether it be the word, be it a letter. I mean, it's normal. We all do it. Right? Be it a word that they didn't know, that wasn't in the vocabulary as yet. That's normal. So they discover those there. And that revision time, that constant revision, gives them a time, gives them an opportunity to make the notes their own, Because through going through the material that they've learned, okay, they can determine whether they understand it or they don't. And also, they can really begin to tweak it. In other words, put some of their own, rewrite it if need be, okay? Personalize it some more. Or go back to the class teacher or relative or parents and really ask for clarification on the notes or on the case of a teacher of a particular concept, okay? So it's through revision that primary school students really understand what they've taken down. Of course, they may understand it while it is being taught or presented in class, but that real intuitive understanding to really know the material off your head to the point that you can really fully get a topic and apply what you've learned, you have to be revising your notes, okay? And people, parents should ensure that that happens, okay? Of course, the children are young, they're playful. Some of them may tell you they don't like school a lot. However, it's still important that they go over what they have, right? What they've learned for the day. It is still important that they really make sure that whatever that is learned, they understand, okay? It makes sense to them, and they can use it. So that is important, and that is the very first point, number one. In addition to going over notes, in addition to revising, students need to do their homework. And, well, I'm a primary school teacher as well, for those who know me personally. For those who don't, I guess you know now. However, it's one of the biggest things, it's one of the biggest reasons why students don't do well. They don't do extra work at home. And like I tell students, the homework is always for them. Also, the homework is an opportunity to really apply what you've learned in class, expound on it, see how well you know the material, test your knowledge of the material, right? And also, opportunity for you to learn more on your own if you have a longer assignment, okay? For example, if you have a few math problems, so you get a chance to practice a particular concept, see how well you understood it. Perhaps you may get a problem in another phrase in another way, and you may have to really infer what is meant, but apply the same underlying principle to solve the problem. It's really testing your knowledge and your application, okay? And the problem is that a lot of children do not recognize and understand the importance of homework. I just mentioned both reasons why they're important. There is nothing wrong with a child doing homework and not being able to complete it. Well, I won't say complete, not being able to do it perfectly, get all correct. What is important is that the child tries and the child challenges his or herself. That is most important. Okay, the child doesn't just drop the books in the bag and not look at it until the next day. Okay, as I said earlier, they may have understood parts of what was taught, but if they didn't try to apply it, they would never really get it. And they'll come back the next day and they blank. And as a teacher, you'll be bewildered. You wonder, what is wrong? Why aren't they getting it? And they got it yesterday. That's the worst thing. So, again, people, for those listening who have children, and for educators listening as well, remind the students and remind your children or family members and all family members of the importance of homework. And homework shouldn't occupy students for many, many hours while they're at home. The purpose of homework is not to, you know, extra school. So they have no playtime. They have to be a balance. And we touch on that in a bit. But they have to really make sure that whatever they learn, that they remember it, they understand it. It's not just about writing notes. You need to understand what's there, right? And they can begin learning more in addition on top of what they've learned, or they could move on to another topic and be confident in the ability to apply what they've learned and master the material, right? So that is homework, people. And homework should be done consistently. Don't do it today and tomorrow. you don't know where it went to. Alright? Make sure that parents, see to it that you're showing the homework. Ask them to show you the homework. Some of them hide it. Alright? And homework should challenge a student. Even the better student, it should challenge them. The better students will tell you that the homework is too easy and they would want more. I'm sure teachers, parents, hall members may know people, know students, have family members, relatives who are that way. They're just good. They're sharp. And yeah, it shows that they're passionate about whatever subject area it is, whatever topic that they're working on, they're practicing on. That is good. Right? The child should have to develop a love and enthusiasm for a particular subject or particular topic. Right? So they should do homework, and it's not just whether they like the topic or they don't like the topic. Even when they don't like it and they're not very good at it, the homework is to help them practice and to push through those barriers, those weaknesses that they have, those limiting beliefs that they have that they cannot do it or they're not good at it. Right? So they need to do the homework. And to add to that, especially for those who take lessons, and I have given lessons before to a few students, and one of my observations is that yes, sometimes you teach students, you explain material to students and they get it perfectly. You can really see that inside, they get the inside, like they didn't really get it in class and they get it now. They really understand it. But they don't go home and they don't apply what they've learned. They don't do the homework. Okay? Whether it's class homework or lessons, they don't follow up. And that's where the actual learning takes place. And children need to realize that. And those parents who, yes, they love giving their children opportunities, lessons. Sometimes they pay high prices. Yeah. But they have to make sure children do the homework. Because you have to make sure that they're actually learning what they should. Okay? So, listeners, spend a while on homework, but that is extremely important. Do not forget that one. Thirdly, and I did touch on it a while ago, students should balance work and play. Alright? Primary school we're talking about right now. They should balance work and play. Children need to play, people. Again, primary school, they've been in school from what, 9 to 3, and of course most times, or most of the day rather, they're sitting in the classroom and they're focusing, whether it's on a lesson or doing a particular assignment, a particular exercise, and they need to move around, right? They need to really release that stress that they have built up throughout the day. Of course, lessons may be enjoyable, but that is not the point, right? Students still need to play, right? They need to exercise, they need to get out there, be vibrant, they're children, right? So that is a very important part of their lives. And one tendency, especially for children who are not very academic inclined, one tendency that a lot of educators or parents put on their children is that they burden them for a lot of work. Especially those who really love to play a lot. And I am not saying that you don't give the child much work at all, or you don't give them work at all. That's what I'm saying here at all. However, it has to be balanced. There has to be some balance into the amount of work, the amount of time you allow the child to play. Right? There has to be some balance. And that balance really will develop the child holistically, in that, yes, they may be passing the exams, they may be academically good, right? They may be getting good grades. However, they're active as well, okay? They're active, they're having fun, they're enjoying their schooling, right? And they're a lot happier. Okay, so please remember, as much as you want to push students to do well, as much as you want to really make sure that they top the island or top the class, top the school. We have to balance the children. Get that? Next, here. Now, when you look at preparing for an exam, okay, and these were just general tips. When you look at preparing for an exam, the night before the exam, students need to make sure they get a good night's rest. Yep. Students need to make sure that they get a good night's sleep. They need to go to bed early. They need to go to bed early. And they need to make sure that they get enough sleep. Okay? So that they can focus the next day. Okay? Do not send the child to bed midnight, close to midnight. And the next day they have a test. Make sure they go to bed very early. Some people like to say 9 o'clock. Yes, send the child to sleep 9 o'clock. If that's what they normally do. Alright? They need to get a good night's rest, people. Okay? They need that energy. And that will help them focus throughout the day. That will help them be alert. That will help them recall the concepts that they have done throughout the term, throughout the year, and apply them. Okay? That will really give them that mental energy to tackle the hard questions that await them. To really have them think outside of the box. Okay, so the sleep, getting enough sleep is very, very important. Very important. Next there, in addition to sleep, students need to make sure that their nutrition is right. They are actually having a good balanced meal. Not just on the day of the exam, because you love to stress the day of the exam. Sometimes you see parents buying things for children on the day of the exam. Like they're going to run a marathon. Yes, the exam is a big day, don't get me wrong. However, it has to be consistent. Children have to be eating right. And as I heard someone saying earlier today, yes, they're young and they may not feel the effects of bad eating, but as they get older, they begin to feel it. Okay? That is lifestyle. Now, when it comes to an exam now, it has to be sustained, people. Think of all the time that they're studying. Think of all the work that they are doing. Think of all the homework. Think of all the concepts that they are learning. Okay, think of preparation for the exam. Because preparation for an exam doesn't begin the day before. Remember that. So, it goes on weeks before, months before. So it has to be sustained, right? It has to be sustained. And that is why we here always emphasize good health choices, good dietary choices, okay? Again, children should be drinking a lot of water, all right? To really flush out their internal systems, remove all the waste products that are in their bodies. Okay, they need to be hydrated, right? All these helps. So nutrition, listeners, is extremely important as it comes to a child, student, primary school student. Of course, it's important for the others, but a primary school student preparing for their exams. And that is extremely important. Next, what can parents do to help? So again, we spend a while in primary school, but there are three things that parents are going to help. Again, you need to behave your child emotionally, okay? Encourage them. Get a feel for what mood that they are in. Do they look nervous before the exam? Do they look excited? Do they look confident? If they're nervous, help pick them up, right? Speak to them. Ask them why they're nervous. Maybe that they didn't understand a particular topic. It may be that they did not get a particular concept. They don't feel confident about a particular subject. They're missing something. An assignment hasn't been done. A project hasn't been done. You may be surprised the problem. It may be very solvable. But that problem may have such a large effect on that child's mood. It may adversely affect their preparation and their performance on their exams. Okay? So, parents, guardians, observe your child, okay, and really see what mood that they are in, whether their preparations are, whether their preparations are progressing. Right. Next, her have a discussion with the child. Again, really see what's wrong with them. Okay, see what you can do to help them. See what they can do better. See what you can do better as well. So get in touch with how the child feels. Not just how they seem to feel or how they look, but how they actually feel. Ask them. Don't be afraid to ask them. It's your responsibility. Something is wrong, find out what's wrong. Or if you see something is wrong, find out what is wrong. Right? Don't just see that the child isn't very good or the child doesn't look very comfortable. Or you know when some parents dish out bad comments or very negative comments to their children and they bring them down. Don't be that kind of parent or guardian or sibling. Alright? That is very, very bad. And lastly, we need to ensure that children have clear expectations. A child is not going to get 100% on the test every time. A child may not get 90% on the test every time. As academically inclined, as intelligent as a child may be, that may not always be the case. So it is not necessary that a child be pressured into getting such a high grade. Of course, you need to push a child to do as well as they can and to perform at as high a level that they actually can. However, don't set the bar that they have to get over 95, and if you don't get 95, do not come in the house or you're going to get beaten. No, that is bad. That is negative pressure on the child. Of course, we have parents that are very intelligent when listening, and I'm speaking to you and the others as well, right? Of course, we all love our children to be confident and very intelligent, but not impose unrealistic expectations on them. When they feel less pressure and they're more confident, they do better. Then when they're very good, they're not so confident because they feel so pressured and they have such a high expectation and such a high bar to actually reach. Okay? So that, people, is important. Now, again, listeners, our phone lines are open. If anyone is listening and would like to make a contribution, would like to give us a call, although we don't always get called, but would like to give us a call, the number to reach us, send us a WhatsApp message, whichever is more appropriate, is 714-5574. Again, the number to reach us, call or WhatsApp message, 714-5574. I realize this evening you have quite a few online listeners. Good evening to those listening online. You're well appreciated. Now let us move on to secondary school students and their exam preparation. Now, as I said for the primary school, and that goes for them as well, secondary school students need to revise their notes. They need to revise their notes. Okay? They need to be revising from early. Okay, again, the revision will help them with whatever they don't understand. The revision will help them with whatever they were confused about. They can catch it early, nip it in the bud. The topics that they're doing, of course, rather to them, they keep on doing new topics. And maybe the topic that they have difficulty with is the one probably at the end of the term. But they need to be revising anyways. Okay? Because when you don't revise and you leave everything for last minute and you have to prepare for exams the last minute, when you begin revising and you realize how much you actually don't understand fully, that's where the pressure builds up. That's when you get a little headache, a little nervousness. Everybody feels it. And they know they should be you should have begun revising earlier. And they can feel that pressure because they haven't mastered material. You're not confident at the material as they actually should be. If you look at an A student, you realize that is one thing that sets them apart from the rest. People, they revise. People, they feel confident about the material. Right? Again, some students do better than others. Some students finish the exam quickly. And not because they're rushing or they don't know anything. It's because they're good. They're confident. But that comes through preparation. That comes through revision of notes. That comes through fully grasping the concepts and mastering them. And that could only be achieved, listeners, students, those of you who are listening who are students, through revision, through going over your material, and through practicing. All right, not just reading notes, practicing. For example, if you have a math problem, practice. You have to write an essay. Okay, say you're doing English. Write some essays. Get confident in the format, structure, style. Time yourself. Right? It comes. It all comes. Again, in addition, students need to make sure they understand their learning style. So, one thing that is always good, one thing that research has always shown to be wise, to be very helpful, is students preparing sticky notes, okay, something like you see flashcards, and putting it some places around the house, say in their rooms, so they can see the material, the concepts that they are doing, that they are learning, that they're trying to memorize, that they're trying to understand, and revise it often. So by virtue of actually seeing it often, say on the walls, on objects around, they are reminded of the material and they understand it a little bit more. They remember it. It sticks a little firmer. Alright? So that is a good tip, people. Again, people learn differently. I mentioned learning style. Some people are more auditory. Again, we have auditory, visual, kinesthetic. Kinesthetic has a deep motion. So some people, they learn by doing, right? Moving around, okay? Actually applying a concept rather than just theoretical mode of instruction. So, however you prepare, whatever methods that you use should correlate directly with your learning style. How do you learn best? Do you learn by listening to notes? Okay. Of course, most people, they write their notes down. But do you learn best by the teacher presenting and you barely taking any notes? Because some people have better memories. Do you learn best by writing things down or writing it in your own words? Okay. Or if it's a concept that you're grappling with, do you learn if actually applying and find ways to actually apply that concept? Practical ways to apply that concept. Okay? See a little experiment you can do, a little activity, a fun game. Right? Students actually learn that way as well. And one thing that special educators don't realize is that there is no one size fits all. Right? Students learn differently. And the very reason that some students are in poly is because the way the material is taught, the way the material has been delivered is not tailored to their learning style. And you put these very same students in a different learning environment and immediately start to do well. So you have to be mindful of that. Alright? Again, students learn differently. Students to prepare for exams differently. Get that. Next here, when we look at preparing for the exam day, again, students should be well rested, right? No late night study, no late night cramming, right? Leave the studying for before, the day before. In other words, don't overexert yourself on the day before the exam, because that overexertion will get you nervous, right? It'll get you nervous, it'll get you fidgety, it will get you uncomfortable. And as much as possible, when it comes to your preparation for your exams, students, we need to avoid that. That needs to be avoided. Okay? So that's why it's relevant. It's advised. It's important that you revise the material couple weeks, couple months before, make sure you grasp it, understand it, make sure you can apply it many different ways. So you really have a intuitive understanding of it. Say if it's mathematics, say if it's physics, you don't just understand the formula. Sorry, you don't just understand a formula in a particular context, but you really understand how to use it, how to apply it in different problems, different situations. Okay? Again, we love to learn things in one way and expect to get tested on it in that same way. And when students get exams, they always complain that the teacher never gave it to me like that. But it's the very same concept. It's the very same underlying principle. Alright? So, when it comes to subjects that are very mathematical in nature, you need to make sure that you can apply formula principle in many different ways. That really demonstrates a good grasp and understanding of topic, concept, formula. So the ability to apply the material in many different ways demonstrates good preparation. And speaking of applying the material in different ways, it's advisable that students prepare a study timetable. Okay? And we say study timetables, and from what I've seen, at the beginning of the term, students love to post nice, fancy timetables on their wall. But a lot of them actually do not stick to them. And anybody can write a timetable. Alright? For those of you who think because you write a timetable and stick it up, you are better than others. Yes, a timetable is good, but it's not writing the timetable that makes it good. It's actually following it. Alright? So, students, children, teenagers, you need to follow what you plan, okay? And you need to plan to follow that plan. You need to follow what you plan, you follow the timetable, and you need to plan so that you can follow that plan. In other words, set a timetable that is realistic. Alright, sometimes we have responsibilities, we have things to do after school, we have church. We have many time constraints that would not cater for these. Right? And we set some exorbitant, unrealistic, some pie in the sky timetable that we know that we're never going to follow. We are never going to implement. So the timetable has to be realistic. Okay? There has to be playtime. There has to be study time. And it has to be tailored to you. No one timetable works for everybody. Of course, we have different responsibilities, different things that we are doing, different activities that we do after school. So that will have to be to your discretion. So again, the timetable really helps keep you disciplined, helps keep you accountable as well. Okay, so that you are actually following up, revising, doing your homework, reading up for class, and also preparing for exams. We love to wait at the end of the school year, at the end of the school term, to begin preparing or to begin putting a timetable. Or the only timetable that we get is the exam timetable. And you have to set your own timetable. Alright? If you want to be a good student, that is something that you need. You need a timetable. Okay? Again, as I said a while ago, should not be unrealistic. Do not set something that you know you cannot follow. Or it's too difficult for you to follow or stick to. Be realistic. If you have 1 hour to study or 2 hours, put 2 hours. But make sure during that 2 hours you study and you do nothing else. Alright? Nothing else that is distracting. So really set out a block of time throughout the day. Okay, whether it's in the evening, in the night, late afternoon. But set out a chunk of time where all you do is study. All you do is go over your notes. All you do is practice some questions. All you do is study with your friend. All you do is really see how much you understand the concept and test yourself. Right? So there has to be a block of time for that. And it's not doing so once in a while that will get you prepared for the exam. People is doing it consistently. It's better you do it consistently for a very short amount of time, that it was almost every day, rather than you don't do it at all, or you do it very rarely. All right, so remember that, those who are listening. Moving on, let's speak of the exam room. Again, I didn't speak about that for primary school, but secondary school needs some focusing on. Once I'm in the exam room, some of them freeze, some of them, of course, not literally freeze, but some of them panic, some of them like to say, quote unquote, go blank. Right, so they forgot everything that they have done. Sometimes, even when they have prepared, sometimes they just forget. They're so nervous, they're so fidgety. It happens, right? Now, students that happen to, they have to learn to calm down, okay? And what they need is not just exam preparation techniques, but actually test taking techniques. There's a difference. It's one thing preparing for exam, it's another thing taking the exam properly. Okay, so they need that. So those of you are listening, if you have trouble taking exams, if you are nervous, if you tend to forget what you've learned, if you tend to, you know, just have that negative expectation in your head, despite preparing, you need to examine how you approach your exam. And getting into that, if you have a difficult question, students, you move on from it, right? For questions taking too much time, you move on, go on to something else. Again, the time, the amount of marks that a question has should correspond to the amount of time that you should spend on it. In other words, if a question is 10 marks, you should devote more time to it than a question with 3 marks. Not spend 50 minutes on the time on a question with 3 marks. You can spend that on a question with 10 and use your time more wisely. Oh, finish the exam. Okay, so make sure that doesn't happen to you. Of course, you know, big exam date, you're nervous, many people to impress, many people expecting that you get an A or you do well, and sometimes people panic, right? But however, it's okay to skip questions sometimes if you don't understand it and come back to it, right? But the best way is to pace yourself. The best way is to actually estimate how much time that you will take on a section, on a topic, and do it. Okay, again, the better test takers know the number of marks, they know how long the exam is. Sometimes they get that information beforehand. I guess if they have a timetable, they would get it, and they would actually be able to better gauge how much time they should spend on each question or each section. So therefore, if they have difficulty and they realize they're spending too much time, they move on and they come back. Okay, if they are, what the marks to get, easier marks to get that can they can get quickly, they go get those marks and then they come back. And sometimes when they come back, they get the answers or comes back. Alright, they remember. Or they have an insight that they didn't have before. And they begin answering that question well. Alright? Sometimes it doesn't come one time. I mean, it happens. It happens to the best of us. And those who are out of secondary school, it happens to you too. All right? Sometimes you may have invested a lot and you have no choice but to actually get an E. Depending on the grades for your previous courses, you may have actually need to get an E in that last final course for you to pass the entire course. Okay? So it would even be more necessary, and everybody can and may get nervous. So we need to learn how to deal with it. Okay? You need to learn how to breathe steadily, people. Relax. The exam is not the end of the world. The exam is not purgatory. Yeah, you're not going to hell. Take your time and do the exam. You've prepared, be confident in your preparation. After you've invested a lot of time, you've had your timetable, you've grappled with the concepts, ask questions, clarify things, and you feel ready, you are prepared. Relax. You are going to do well. And apply yourself. Okay? And for those who have difficulty and the time is ending, the time is finishing, and they're panicking and they have an entire section left, do what you can get the most marks in. Right? Do what you can do. Right? If something looks so confusing and you realize there are other marks in places that you've left out, do those first. Right? Even if something is a lot of marks, do what you know for sure you'll get you the marks first. Right? Of course, if something's a lot of marks, you may have spent some time trying to get it. Right? If you've tried, and you cannot get it, doesn't mean that if you don't try more, you won't get it. But by all means, move on to something that you may actually get. Right? Or you feel like you really know, but you didn't have the time to go through as yet. So again, it's important that you try to maximize all the marks that is available to you. Even if you've wasted some time, has elapsed, and really you feel like you're not finished, or you doubt whether you even pass, try to do what you can do. Right? Do what you feel more comfortable, do what you feel more confident in. Additionally, students need to make sure that while you're taking exams, they are well hydrated and energized. Okay? A lot of children don't seem to think that water is important. And water, having water is not just for when you're in the sun, or when you're running, or when you're running a marathon, or when you're having PE, physical education. You need the water every day, even if you're not doing those things. Alright? So, on exam day, it's important that you're hydrated. Okay? It's important that you have water. It's important that you are comfortable. Right? You're not very thirsty. You're not very hungry. Right? You're well fed. You've eaten good food. You feel energized. You feel good. You've slept well before. You're well nourished. Right? You're very relaxed. Your mind is not on something that you should not be. Your mind is on the exam. And you're ready to ace the test. And you feel prepared. You feel confident. Right? So, yeah, you need to be relaxed, people. You need to be relaxed. You need to be... And again, I mentioned many tips here in one. But being assured, being confident comes with you actually doing a lot of the things right. A lot of the basic things right. Again, make sure you're hydrated, you have enough water, making sure that you're comfortable, right? You have no aches. If you want to use the bathroom, you go before, right? So in some sense, they hold it in and the exam passes and they don't go. Right? Ask them some time and go. Even if they have to wait 1 minute for you, go. Right? Because trust me, holding your urine in or your feces in, it's not very good to do. And it may affect your performance because you're uncomfortable. Right? You should be focused on the material, focused on actually completing the exam, doing the best that you can, and finishing the exam on time. So that's the only thing that you actually should be focused on. Right? That is the only thing that you should be focused on. So you need to be comfortable, you need to feel good on the inside. You need to feel good on the inside, students. Finally, I'm going to move on to the tertiary section. And that is university, a post-secondary education. First and foremost, here, students, those attending colleges around the country, around the world, wherever you are listening, or where you know someone that you can impart this advice on, give yourself enough time to study. Again, as coursework gets completed, as assignments, group projects, meetings come up, the exam will come up quickly too. So you need to begin studying early. Right? There's not much more for me to say. You have to start studying early. Revising. Make sure as you learn something, you understand it. Make sure as you taught something, you understand it. If there is something that a lecturer taught, a concept, something that they taught and you don't get it one time. Go to them. If you cannot go to them, get it online. Right? Do not move on to another concept when you have understood the current one. Because trust me, you may be able to push it under the carpet, but as you get closer to exam time, it'll bite you back. Alright? So please make sure you understand everything that you are taught. Right? Make sure you understand everything that you are taught. Because as exams, assignments, after school activities, group activities, begin to come up quickly. Trust me, you begin to forget very, very, very quickly that you had a problem with a topic. Because the work is so quick, you have so much more work to do, and it gets more hectic by the day, by the week. So please seek clarification and make sure that there are no stones unturned as it comes to your comprehension of concepts, topics that were taught. Secondly, organize your study space. Make sure that you have a comfortable place to study. Make sure that you have a place that is noise free. Of course, nowhere can be literally soundproof. There will be some noise, but somewhere that is generally quiet. And make sure that you have some time to actually focus on your work. Okay, be it going over something, be it studying, be it revising notes, be it revising your notes. Make sure you have some time to do that. Some clear and quiet time to actually do that. So that is important. Thirdly, and again, especially at that level, you have to know your learning style. If you're better, if you're a visual learner, again, you may be the type who loves diagrams, flowcharts. Again, there is mind maps as well. Mind maps really help. It's basically a diagram in a nutshell showing the entire topic. Okay? So it'll help if you design your own, color it. Really make it lively, make it visually appealing, because that is how you process information best. That is for visual learners. Look at learners who learn best by audio, for sound. Again, record your lectures. If they're recorded online, if there are online versions of it, if you're taking an online course, whichever one you are doing, maybe that you listen to them instead. Or speak your notes out loud and listen to it. Right? You'll be surprised how much this helps. Okay? We all learn differently, and it pays to know how you learn. And those who are kinesthetic as well, do something with the knowledge that you have been taught. Okay? Say if you're learning computer programming and you learn a new language, a new framework, write something. Write a program, write an app in the framework. Right? Use what you've learned. That's how this type learns best. And let me put it out there. No one can be completely visual, audio, or learn by moving things, doing things, kinesthetic. We all are a mixture of all of them. So find which one you lean more towards. But it doesn't mean that if you auditory, you can write notes as well. Alright? So really fine-tune and tailor what works best for you. So it's a personal thing. Fourthly, in addition to organizing your study space, make sure you have enough time, you have a nice schedule going. So all of these things are actually going. And using charts, diagrams, maps, mind maps to represent the data to really encapsulate all that you are doing, all the concepts, all the topics that you are doing. Make sure that you work on some old exams. Practice on some old exams. Alright? Whether you attend Serafa, whether you attend university, whether you're taking a course online, there must be past papers somewhere. Right? Practice on these. Right? Time yourself. You'll be surprised at the things that you discover. Sometimes you may discover that you're very nervous. You may discover that you thought you understood a topic, concept, but you did not. Or something that you did not understand. So you practice not just to practice your test taking skills, but to also practice harder questions. Because a lot of times the sample exams are a little harder than the ones that you actually do in class, or even for homework. So beware and make sure you get these and you work them. Even for CXE as well. Those who write CXE, although the exams seemingly are getting easier by the year, but they may realize that the actual class exams are a little harder than what is in the textbook or what they do day to day, what the teacher do day to day, the examples that the teacher does day to day. Okay, that's why teachers try to give a lot of passwords in class to really get them, the students oriented, acquainted with the level of difficulty. some of the questions so that they could really, they can think more abstractly and really solve problems of a similar level of difficulty when they actually get them. Again, it helps to, so that's my next tip there, number five. It helps to explain what you know to others. Okay, see if you can explain so that somebody else can understand it. That's a very good test. That's a litmus test. Okay, say you learn, if you say you know about, for example, marginal costing, okay, principle of counts, see how well you can explain that topic to, say, someone who knows nothing about accounting, and see where they can actually pick it up, pick up some things, right? You want to know if you understand something, explain to somebody else, then you begin to poke holes in your understanding. That's a very good exercise, not just for accounting, but for any subject, trust me, because you will need to know in order to be able to impart knowledge into somebody else. Your teachers or your professors have to know before they can teach you. So with that, again, for you to be able to explain it to somebody else, you need to have a good grasp of it, and by doing so, you'll be able to see weaknesses where you kind of not sure, or you really uncertain as to how to answer the question, and really what you thought you knew, so you'd be able to correct these things and really augment your understanding of the topic or the concept at hand. Organize study groups with friends. Again, especially at college, many students taking similar courses. Again, there's a lot more socialization opportunity. Use some of that time to study together as well, right? Study as a group. Of course, we all have to balance school and our lives. Sometimes some people work while they go to school too. But you have to leave some time to actually work as a team, as a group. The major advantage of that is that your peers, those you work with, may be good at what you are weak at. And via the association, they'll help pull you up. So if it's a part of a topic that you don't understand, they may explain to you in a way that you may get it. And you may help them as well. So you helping them, you're actually reinforcing your understanding of a particular topic. So you're actually strengthening your strong points on the topic while you improve those you're weak at. Okay, try to get students who are a little better than you. Okay, but within groups, there should be a mix. Students who are very good, students who are not very good, so that everybody could be pulling each other up. Okay, everybody should be able to challenge each other. That's an important thing. Alright, everybody should be able to teach each other something. Alright, so make sure there is good variability within those groups. And when it comes to preparing for exams, especially when you have a very hectic schedule, it helps. Because you'd have students who are actually taking the same courses that you have taken, that are actually taking the same courses that you have taken right now, and may actually have taken those courses. Because yes, you may be taking the course now, but if it's more than 1 year, they may have taken that course already. Okay, so again, find people who are similar. Again, that is why class group projects are good. Again, to see how well you can work as a group, and also to really get a chance to work on your team building skills and how well you can actually work with others. So that is very good. That's a very good option that everybody should explore. Or students, or are you very good or not very good, you should explore. With that said, everybody, the next thing is that college students should take breaks. And I'm sure they're pretty good at that already. Many students socialize a lot. Whether it's party, whether it's go out. Some of them, whether it's even drink too. So many students actually get a healthy social life. They already have a healthy social life at college, at university. So even these students, especially those who are, they really hit the books hard, right? And they don't play that much, as much as they mature.